Okay, hi folks, welcome back to part 5 of my making a Whirligig video series. By now, after a few days, the glue has cured. I said before, I just didn't have time to proceed. Normally you should wait for only 24 hours until the glue has hardened enough to take away the reminders. So that's what I will do now. Drill out the glue reminders from the bearing tubing. Shaft. Of course, you want the head portion of the lure run smoothly onto the shaft later. You've got to clean this very thoroughly. Okay, especially take care of the transition to the bearing bead to get a sharp corner down there. I would later work this over with a file as well. Thing I said before, the blade of this Stanley knife is pretty blunt. I won't bother to change it for this work, because if I mislead the knife, I don't want it to cut into the sealed timber. There's still something there. Okay, seems to be clean now. I don't feel anything anymore. So let's see. Yeah. This one is not totally clean yet. The drill bit is a bit smaller than the tubing inner diameter. Just too lazy to pick a perfectly sized one. Should work out this way as well. Hopefully. If it wouldn't work out, I would still have to look for a 2mm drill bit. Oh, okay. Spins freely, has sufficient play. Perfect. Okay. I'm switching the camera off now to change tools. Now I would start to remove the glue reminder from the surface of the lure. You would just stroke the rotating router bit gently over the surface. Do not apply pressure to it. The surface of the sealed timber is hard enough that the router bit wouldn't easily bite into it, provided you do not apply too much pressure. Just stroke it gently over the surface. It will not damage deep into the, it will not go deep into the timber. If I'm using PVC hard foam, it's a different thing, because the surface of that stuff is very soft, so you're likely to cut blemishes into it. But the propionate-treated timber is a different thing. The last bit is done by hand anyway, so now I'm going to change to a cylindrical router bit. So, cylindrical router bit to do the corner. I prefer this conical router bit with the round head for surfaces, because simply because it doesn't have a sharp edge at the bottom that won't be likely to cut scratches into the wood. This is why I'm using this router bit for a surface and this cylindrical one for corners at the eyes. Complicated in front of the camera, but just to give you an idea how I do this thing, I will do it more thoroughly without the camera later. Okay, now switch the router bit again. Okay, here's a very small 2 mm cylindrical bit to free the eyes. Cylindrical bit now. Okay, it's a bit difficult to do it on the workbench. I like to hold it against my chest. Bits are done by hand anyway, with a knife blade and a file. So how about this? As said before, just gently stroke the rotating tool over the material, and if you just gently stroke it, it will not bite into the wood, because it's quite a thick sealer coat on it. Okay, there's some more there. As the layers of glue get thinner by routing them away, they just peel off from the propionate surface. Just remember, just gently stroke the tool over the workpiece. Do not apply pressure to it. Then it would not bite into the material, because the propionate layer is very hard. Okay. Now filing is in order. Do this rivet head first to get a sharp transition to the shaft. Now around the rivet head. The purpose of all this stuff is to first get a clean surface and possibly remove all glue reminders that would be loose and maybe later come off whilst painting the lure. So I'd like to remove them as good as possible. Glue and propionate tend to clog up the teeth of your rotating tools and your file, so you frequently brush them away with such a file brush. An ordinary steel bristled brush would do as well. Because if the teeth of your file are clogged up, you won't cut anymore. Okay, now the belly eye. I want all loose glue reminders to be gone, so they could not disturb my painting later. For the very sharp corners, I'm using my blunt Stanley knife again. Make sure never cut against the wood. Always lead your blade against metal. So you would not make any scratches or nicks to the sealed timber. Okay, I will do it more thoroughly later without the camera anyway. I don't want to bore you. Just to show the basic work operations that I do to my lures. Basically, I am doing all my lures this way. It may look very elaborate, and surely it's not worthwhile if you make lures to sell, but I don't mind of any added effort to my lures. I just want to be happy with them and have confidence that I did my possible best to make them durable. Remember, always lead your blade against the metal. One more thing, the lure eyes would receive scratches and little indents now. This is why I would never attach my line straight to the line tie. I will always use a snap, because these little nicks inside of the steel wire eye could damage your line. To me, fishing for pike is not an issue, because I'm using wire leaders anyway. But if you're an America bass fisherman, I think you guys tied your lure straight to the line, and you should still use a snap. First, you could quickly change lures. Second, if there are any nicks to the wire eye, they might damage your line, and you lose a fish or a lure. So that's just one word of warning. Okay, looks good so far. Now I would gently use the file and stroke over. You know, doesn't bite into the material as well. Just removes all those little bits of glue reminders. Okay, I will do this more thoroughly without the camera. I don't want to bore you. Maybe. Okay, I think the focus of the camera was off anyway. I switched to the workbench. Got to do it at my chest. So I was carried away doing the work. Forgot about I switched the focus of the camera. Anyway, as said before, I do not want to bore you with this stuff anymore. I'll clean that up thoroughly. I guess this is you got the way it works for me. Okay, I'll switch this off. Okay, same thing for the front section. Luckily, not so much glue reminders have been smeared onto this one. It's a bit tricky to lead the fire blade around the fins, not to make indents to them. But as said before, I want possibly all glue reminders to vanish, because maybe it might disturb proper paint adhesion. Don't want them to come loose later after all painting and top coating has been done. So I'd rather take the effort to remove them thoroughly. I'm always working this way, pressing the workpiece against my chest, and look at what I'm doing from above. Not quite easy to film though. It's just to give you an idea. Everybody would have his own preferences of about the ways how to work. Okay. When you're finally happy about the removal of glue reminders, you just buff all surfaces again. That's a bit complicated on the head section. Often you would still find glue reminders this way that haven't been removed. filing is in order again. Yeah, but I'm happy with this now. Especially on the roundings, glue might remain there. But it looks pretty good now. Okay. Yeah, these body roundings are delicate. Both in terms that glue reminders might still be located there, and also it's a bit hazardous to file over the roundings in terms that the file might still bite into the timber, which you surely do not want. Okay, if I'm done, now it's time to apply first a primer coat, so I'd use a brush to wipe all dust away and hang it in the rack. If you want, you could also wipe it down with mineral spirit to remove all dust and grease. I do not usually do that, I never had problems. But if you feel better this way, you can surely do it. Just a demonstration. I will do it more thoroughly without the camera. Get all dust off the workpiece in a nutshell. Okay. Now I'm making myself a wire hook to hang the head section to dry. First make kink there. Oops, it's the other way around. That it cannot slide anymore. Let's sit firmly, okay. No, that's from the wrong side. I do it this way. Okay. Because I need to do a kink on this side as well. And because of the tapered end, it's easier for me to reach that spot with my paintbrush. Okay, that's fine. So, just bend the hook for hanging. This one's a bit too long. Another hook for hanging. You would bend the wire hooks for the lure part to hang absolutely straight down, not canted. Later, it's important when doing the epoxy top coat that you would not get epoxy dripping on one side. So you want this thing to hang absolutely straight in the rack, not like this or like this. Let it hang straight, not this way, not this way, just straight down. Okay? Okay, I'm not so sure whether the camera captured making this hook. Maybe I didn't switch it on properly. Anyway, here's the hanger hook to hang this thing in the rack. Now I would put on the first primer coat. This is acrylic primer. I'm using acrylic paints exclusively. Put this here. And I need a rather fine brush. No, that's too fine. Here it is. Okay. The painting goes, I would put on two primer coats for better coverage. After two base coats of a base color of acrylic paints. And then I would most likely do a mottled mottled finish, yes, that's what you call it in English, with three or four different colors onto the base coat, wet and wet, but we'll get back to this later. I have never bothered about airbrushing. When I was a boy, I used to make plastic models and all painting these by hand brush as well, so I just stuck to it. I don't mind about the added effort if I would sell my lures. Maybe I would have to go with more economic working processes, but I'm happy with this. I know my lures, they do not look as good as all the lures of all of the fellow lure makers out there doing the top-notch airbrush jobs, which I truly admire. But for myself, I'm just okay with brush painting. Since my childhood, I'm used to it. So, I do not think that fish would care about top-notch paint jobs. Either they are willing to strike lures or they are not. That's my experiences. And if they are not, they won't strike them. You gotta use natural minnow bait then, either dead or live. Just my experiences. And in fact, I'm also too cheap to invest into airbrush gear, since I've got all the paints here, and also I'm too comfortable to learn this new technique, because for my own lure making, just for my own pleasure and recreation, it's not necessary. If I would make lures for sale, it's a different thing, that I would have to do it, but I'm fine with the brush painting. Okay. See, let's say there was a time I've used spray cans for painting. After a great disaster, when a whole bunch of more than 1 dozen lures, the paint started to crackle due to spray paints were not compatible to one another, I've quit on spraying. It was too much of a shock for me. So I got back to brush painting. I've been using these model making animals by Revell or Hambro, but later I found that acrylic paints are much better than these solvent based paints, because you have more options in terms of getting better shading and You could mix them to any tone you want, which is not possible with the solvent-based model-making animals. Require different painting techniques, and I think you're just more versatile with the acrylic paints. And also, they don't smell, and they dry faster, which speeds up your working. You know, if I'm doing a dozen of lures at one time, and if I was finished with the last lure, the first one would have been already dry, and I can continue. With the solvent-based paints, I would have to wait until the next day to proceed, and with these acrylic paints, it's a lot faster to get to your results. And they don't stink. Okay. This one should be finished now. As said before, maybe you can see it on the camera, the coverage is not perfect. This is why I would apply a second coat. The instructions on the paint can say after 12 hours you can apply the second coat, but I found that 2 hours of drying time are enough until the second coat. Okay, I'll hang this one to dry. Now I'll take the rear section and apply the first coat of paint, of primer. I've been using this primer for many years and I'm satisfied with it. It has filler properties. I mean, if I would do airbrush, I want an absolutely smooth surface, which this one does not make. And I would not sand the lures over, because later if I paint them with the acrylic paints, wet, the lure would have a rough surface similar to an oil painting. If you ever stroked your fingers over an oil painting, you see that's pretty rough surface. So my lures have this as well. But in the end, the rough surface would get evened out by the three top coats of epoxy. So, and as I said before, it doesn't really matter to me. I do admire the pretty nice work of my fellow lure makers that utilize airbrush, but I'm doing it this way. I'm happy with it. If you do airbrush, you will want to sand it over absolutely smooth. And I do not have this problem this way. And apart from that, these paint coats are also a lot thicker than spray coats, so I'm thinking maybe they add a little bit to the durability of the lure as well. In terms of a hook rash, probably wouldn't occur that fast. That hook rash gets down to the sheer timber. Okay, I would not film the second second primer coating, because would get boring to you, and there's not really much more I could tell you at this stage. Make sure you paint all the eyes thoroughly around the eyes. As said before, this primer is having filler properties, so if you got little holes in your glue, they would fill them up as well. Okay, I'll switch this off now. Just wiping off the paint reminders and clean my brush and simple jug of water. Wipe it dry. And that's it. So now I'm gonna have lunch. And by the time I would have filled my belly, paint would have been dry and I could proceed with the second primer coat with acrylic primer. Alright. Okay, people. Two primer coats have been applied to the Whirligig now. Now it's time to put on the base color coat. I picked a beige color because I want to do the lure in a gold, copper, brown pattern, which has proven to be quite successful during summer. So I want the belly a bit darker as well, not white or pearl. So just shaking this up a bit, picking the Whirligig's head section, and now I would apply two paint coats, two basic paint coats. So the primer has dried for maybe 2 or 3 hours now. That's okay. As said before, I'm too cheap to invest into airbrush and I've been used to this hand painting for 45 years now, making plastic models during my boyhood and early teenage years. I do admire the very pretty airbrush jobs of fellow lure makers out there, but I'm one of the few painting by hand. And what I found, people painting by hand brush, you can identify their style. Because everyone would develop his own style of painting. Probably when using airbrush, it's not that significant, though it looks much more pretty, but the fish, for example, I think to have read the big massive pike still has a very small brain that he maybe would not able to tell the difference of an top-notch airbrush paint job or this simple hand brush. Just a fraction of a second the lure passes the fish by and it has to decide whether to strike it or not. So if the general coloration matches, like neon bright colored for stained water, or looking a little bit more natural for clear waters, that's enough. I'm just used to paint by hand, ever was. And I can skip masking. And I won't have to worry to mess up, won't have to clean an airbrush gun. And one more important thing, I just do not have the space to store more gear down my small messy workshop down here in the basement. Okay, that's the head section, let's hang it to dry. Now comes the front section. I'm trying to paint around the bearing rivet here, though it will surely be covered with epoxy top coat in the end. So I'll have to find out if the head would spin freely. I might clean off the epoxy and file it away when it's dry from the pop rivet. By the way, I've read about issues you should not touch lures with your hands whilst painting. Maybe some people have greasy fingers or whatsoever. I mean, I've never had issues with that in terms of paint adhesion. So I always touch them with my hands, bare hands. Simply because I can assess every portion better than if I would clip it to the with using a spring-loaded clamp. But everybody should do as he pleases or as it works better for the person. This is just the way I do it. You do not have to necessarily follow this. If you feel something else works better for you, I'm just showing my own working methods, and I'm far from claiming that these would be the best. It's just the way I do it. Again, when I'm finished with this first color coat, I would not show the second painting, because it's rather the same, just for better coverage. And then I'll be back when applying the other colors, three or four colors, onto the base coat in wet and wet techniques. So I'll be back for that. See ya. Okay, one more thing. Talking about the final paint coats with the wet and wet techniques. I've already done the small 2-inch Whirligig in a kind of shed pattern. Base coat has been mother of pearl, then light gray, olive green, and kind of metallic gray gunmetal to make up for a shed pattern. Here's the head portion. Right, can you see it this way? I've done this one whilst waiting for the paint of the big Whirligig to dry. I've done a deep diving shed in also light beige base coat, light yellow, olive green, and linden green to make up for a light perch pattern. And here's another one I did now whilst waiting for the paint to dry. Shallow diving shed with the light gray base coat copper, metallic gray, and a little bit of black, all to make up for a rather darker appearance. This lure is diving down to maybe 1 to 2 feet, 2 feet rather. So I wanted something darker. So this is how I do my paint coats. Most likely I do not have any specific plans. I just think I want something very bright, something dark, so, and I'll play with the colors lure after lure to make them a little different, and so that's my fun about it. Okay.